This morning we're dealing with a very important topic. As you can see, why medical data is so valuable to criminals and why everyone must be compliant. I hadn't realized quite what a problem this was until I did some research, as I tend to do with these things. I think we're all familiar with companies like Target having major hits on their security systems and having millions of credit cards ripped off. We're perhaps less familiar with what happens in the medical business. Interestingly, about 7% of all adults in the United States will be hit or have been hit with some form of identity theft. So by a show of hands, has anybody here in the room had anything to do with identity theft in their own history or their family? Wow, okay, that actually exceeds the national stats. So increasingly, it's about a $3 trillion healthcare industry that we have here in the United States. And one of the things that I hadn't realized is that increasingly thieves are going after children's records. Well, why is that? Well, if you think about your bank robbery, your robbers want to get in at night if they can, so they've got hours and hours to spend. The criminals like time. So if you have a fresh, unused social security number, you have several years before that child's going to go for a Pell Grant or something like that, and suddenly find out that they have appalling credit. Interesting story here. A 14-year-old boy unknowingly had $607,000 in fraudulent debt and a bad credit history that went back more than 10 years. Several credit cards and a foreclosed mortgage were already in his credit history, all from a suspect living in California. The thief established good credit for the first 10 years. Okay? Time. The passage of time. And was able to finance a $605,000 home in California with a first and a second mortgage. Okay. Interesting stuff, isn't it? And it's getting worse and worse. And it seems to me that if you look back at history, history is a great teacher of all of these things. Willie Sutton, probably the most prolific bank robber in US history, was reportedly, he said, when asked by a reporter, "Willie, why do you rob banks?" And he said, "Hell, that's where the money is." Today, the Willie Suttons of the world really have no further place to look than in our offices. Okay? Are you living with legacy systems? Are you living with computers that are 6, 7, 8, 10 years old? Things that kind of work really well with the system that you had a few years ago? Guys, they're not enough. It's all changing. And we're very privileged to have this morning, as we usually have here at MOROF, some very, very experienced and excellent speakers on this subject. And I'll introduce them one by one as we go through here. Initially, Jeff Holt. Jeff is a vice president of PNC Corporation. He tells me he's not a banker because, in fact, what he does is he works with medical practices. He's your best buddy if you have a medical practice. He's the one that's going to advise you on succession. He's the one that's going to advise you on how to avoid the kind of fraud that we're talking about today. You can see his bio up there. I don't need to read all of that to you, but he has his bachelor's from the University of Michigan. Actually, there are two on the panel that have that distinction today. And Jeff, I've come to know as a man who has incredibly deep knowledge of his subject. So we're enormously privileged to have him with us here this morning. So please help me welcome Jeff Holt. The next speaker we have is Tatiana Melnik. She's based out of Tampa, again, a University of Michigan law graduate. Her specialty, actually, she has a wonderful mission statement here, just a terrific definition of what she does. She is an attorney who helps her clients protect and secure information. Pretty succinct, huh? She concentrates her practice on IT, data privacy and security, and healthcare regulatory compliance, and regularly speaks on healthcare IT legal issues, including HIPAA, cloud computing, telemedicine, data breach, reporting requirements, and contract drafting. She represents healthcare providers and their vendors. She's a managing editor of the Nanotechnology Law and Business Journal and a regular contributor to the Journal of Healthcare Compliance. She has actually 3 degrees. That's a lot by anybody's standards. And again, we're very, very happy to have Tatiana with us. So let's go on to the third one. Karl. Good morning. Karl is president of Eukairos Tech, and he specializes in the design, development, and deployment of point-of-care systems for a doctor's office management system, and he provides peace of mind for his clients through proactive managed IT services. That's everything we want for our practices, isn't it? So we're delighted to have these three excellent speakers with us today. Help me welcome them again. Thank you.
Good morning. We want to thank you all for coming here today on this important topic. So whether you're in a medical practice or not, it really does not matter because we're all targets, whether you're a medical business, or just personally. We're all targets for the information that we have electronically. So understanding the importance of why to keep it secure, who's going after it, and how are essential for all of us. And those are the things we're going to cover today. So today we're going to look at, you know, where we are, you know, today's industry, the status. We're going to look at HIPAA. We're going to look at FIPAA. If you're not familiar with FIPAA, you will be more so, obviously, today. Regulatory framework, the rules between the two of those. Why should you care? That's always good to know. It's like, this is good information, but why do I care? Why do I care? Why do my clients care? We're going to go over that. So we're going to give you some case studies. And then, what do you do now? Now that we've bombarded you with all this knowledge, what's the best practices? How do you take care of things? How do you make sure to, you know, lower those risks of things happening to you or your clients? And we'll go over those things. Okay. All right. So I'm going to go over some statistics. There's a lot of statistics here about how bad the data breaches are happening, how things are increasing, and we all know the medical industry has really been forced into the IT arena compared to dental, who's been there for years more so. And now medical has been kind of forced and kind of shoved down their throats. And then, you know, the physicians just love that. And as they try to transition and understand it and get comfortable with it and implement it into their practice and daily operations, understanding how to do it in a secure manner and why they need to has been a challenge. And that creates more activities for us to work. Okay, it's like job security for all of us here, unfortunately. But it is. So and the thing is also, being in Florida, why should you care more is this. Florida is number one in the United States for identity theft. Number one. So that means that by being in Florida as a business or as an individual, your chances of your identity being stolen or your client's, your patient's identity being stolen is largely much greater than just about everybody else in the United States. Concerning, right? Okay. So, and two things, if you look at the value of a medical record versus the value of a credit card, you know, number, just like say we gave the examples of Target was in this. Medical records on the black market, because the amount of information that can answer questions when they ask you security questions is really the key, is 30 to 50. Well, it's ranging $30 to $50 on the black market per medical record, okay? Compared to a credit card is 3 to 5. So when they steal credit card information, they look to get it in volume as much as possible to make it worth it. Now, they don't have to steal that many records really to make it worth it in comparison, $30 to $50 per medical record, okay? So that's why we're focusing so much, say, on medical records. That's why the government is focusing, because of the amount of information that is taken and what can be done with it. The other thing is the individual, as your client, your patient, the impact to them and why they're not going to love you so much is the cost to them, besides the headache and the time, can be in the thousands to get it resolved, in the thousands, besides being damaging to their credit. and they think about the interest expense, because now they're going to try to borrow. They can't. They can. If they can, the interest rates are phenomenal. Okay? Even though they say, hey, somebody, you know, affected my identity. And so it's a major impact all around. Okay? So, again, there's a lot of statistics here. You can see that it's a severe, severe concerning problem. Okay? We're going to move on. So what are the challenges? What is today's landscape in the healthcare IT area? So conversion of paper to electronic, obviously, that's the challenge. Again, you know, the EMR, EHR, and even though we're doing that, I know there's practices that still have the paper files out there and have not totally gone paperless, but, you know, the everything electronic now is out there, and getting that conversion done is challenging. The use of IT is up, so security concerns are increased. Data storage on-premises versus on the cloud. So now you've got where you've stored it on-site. Now it's the transition, you know, securing that transition from where the practice is to where the cloud base is, making sure that's secure. Practice management modifications, rise of identity theft and cyber attacks, increased demands on infrastructure, you know, alteration expectations of customer base, shortage and qualified SMEs within domain, and presumptive and reactive reporting. So, I don't want to read all the slides, but these are some major, major concerns that are all impacting just around IT. We know in medical practices, they have enough to be concerned about with healthcare reform, but now, you know, this is added on, right? Here's just an example. So, we're not talking always about, to say, targets and the large, you know, hospital networks is being targeted. You know, practices are easy targets, and a lot of times they don't even know that they've been hit when they've been hit because of how poor their infrastructure is. Okay, example study: 150,000 settlement with a small nonprofit mental health clinic. Right, small mental health clinic. I mean, who would really think to target that as far as being at something at that type of facility? And the reason is, and this is extremely common, firewalls not preventing the intrusions, and unsupported software not patched. So it's a valid example. So outdated technology, outdated software. Now think how many practices that you're aware of that have the outdated software and technology. Okay. So and as well as maybe just, you know, they're not compliant. So, you know, being compliant doesn't mean that you're not at risk. You know, we're going to go into that and show that later on. That's an important point. Okay, so Tatiana is going to take it from here, and then Karl will go, and then I'm going to kind of finish up at the end. Okay.
Thank you very much, Jeff. So I'm going to talk briefly about the HIPAA regulatory framework, and then Karl will add in some of the details on the specific HIPAA rules, and then I'll return my attention to FIPA. So hopefully everybody in this room knows what HIPAA is. Hope, maybe. But it's a relatively old statute when we're looking at data privacy and security requirements, right? It was passed initially in 1996. It's broad. It applies to covered entities, business associates, and subcontractors. It's important to remember that the first line here is covered entities, right? We do see a lot of healthcare data out in the market, but not all of that is subject to compliance with HIPAA. On the other hand, right, if you're in Florida, it is subject to compliance with FIPA, right? So it's important to remember that. But if you're looking at HIPAA, your first line is covered entities. So are you working with healthcare provider, a hospital, a health plan, things like that? It protects protected health information, which is a very broad category that basically covers anything and everything that has to do with a person's healthcare. Okay. It was modified in 2009 by the HITECH Act. HITECH was put in place because while HIPAA was passed in 1996, it was rarely, if ever, enforced. And with the move to the electronic healthcare record systems, the mandate to move to meaningful use, the government was really concerned about whether or not people would adopt electronic healthcare records if they knew HIPAA was not being enforced. So they mandated enforcement of HIPAA through HITECH. HITECH put in place mandatory penalties. Now, again, think about it. Have you ever seen a regulator fine anybody $100? It's just not going to happen. The smallest we've seen today is $50,000. The largest has been way above 1.5 million. So please don't think that that 1.5 is some sort of ceiling. It's not. Here are, here's an example of some of the relationships that we can see in the healthcare space. It's very complicated. Typically, the subcontractor level, you're gonna have the most amount of data, and these organizations tend to be the least compliant. So if you're looking at who's creating the most risk for you, it's those lower run entities that have data on everyone and somehow think they're not subject to HIPAA, right? HIPAA itself has four rules, and we typically just call them the HIPAA rules. So if you've ever read a business associate contract, it'll say you agree to comply with the HIPAA rules. This is what it refers to. And usually, at least from the legal side, what we're looking at is the security rule, the privacy rule, and the breach notification rule. The enforcement rule comes into place when you have the Office of Civil Rights knocking on your door trying to take an enforcement action against you. And that sets out basically the rules of the road for how that communication goes. Otherwise, when you're looking at compliance, you're going to look at these three main rules. And the breach notification rule was added by HITECH. I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to Karl to talk more specifically about the rules.
Thank you. Good morning. The four rules are basically set aside to generate a set of standards that the industry can agree on. As Tatiana mentioned, it's boiled down to those four categories, the first being the privacy rule. And the privacy rule is what makes something private. Those standardizations of identifying what kind of information is going to be deemed as protected. The security rule establishes certain standards that reflect how that information will be secured and protected, the different types of coverages that the entities have to take in order to ensure through best practices in their practice management, in their IT security issues, and so forth. So it's all surrounded or encompassing how they protect that PHI, or patient health information. The breach notification rule is determined and set aside for how what defines a breach and those standards that are associated with that, and what would have to be done in the event that a breach is detected or identified, and what steps you need to do in order to notify the various parties involved. And you can see that in the individual notification, you obviously got to notify the person that's been involved in that breach. You have to notify the media if the size of the breach is sizable. And then you have to get into making a report with the OCR, the secretary of the OCR, and then notifying any of the business associates that you're involved with. So it really boils down to, well, then what is a breach? A breach is any time somebody identifies or determines information that they shouldn't. It's basically on a need-to-know type of basis. If information is disseminated that shouldn't be identified to some party or entity that has no access to it, then that's a breach. And the key issues with breaches now is the fact that it has to be done on a presumptive basis. If I think a breach has occurred, then a breach has occurred. It's not a question of identifying one and then reacting. The enforcement rule ties into, and this is where the penalties and so forth come in. This is where the HIPAA Omnibus and the HITECH Acts try to bring some enforcement behind what would take place on that whole breach notification and what penalties are going to be associated with it. And that's essentially how they're going to fund this whole effort of management, is through fines and penalties. So those are the four categories that basically surround the quote-unquote HIPAA rules. I think we're going to get into the regulatory frameworks on FIPA, and I'll turn that back to Tatiana.
Thank you. So HIPAA sets the baseline protection. It's the floor. It's not the ceiling. State laws can be more restrictive and often are more restrictive. Typically, what you'll see is state laws will carve out certain types of data. So you'll have your substance abuse stuff, which is also subject to Part 2 at the federal level. You may have additional requirements under state laws that cover substance abuse. Mental health records tend to have stricter disclosure requirements. And things dealing with an STD-related information also tends to have stricter disclosure requirements. So in some cases, you have to look at these other state laws to see whether or not you have additional requirements for compliance. FIPA is quite broad. It is broader in scope than HIPAA. It covers a lot more information, including your health insurance information. I mean, I'll talk about that in the next slide. But it went into effect on July 1st of last year. Okay? It repealed and wholly replaced the existing law. This was put in place because of the identity theft issues here in Florida. This was the one of the fundamental reasons for the change. Because if you are a resident of Florida, you're about three times as likely to be the victim of identity theft than in any other state. So there are significant issues here. And it applies to every business, whether or not you're actually located in Florida, that handles personal information of Florida residents. Okay, this is the similar in structure to what you see in other states where their state laws apply to data held for their state residents. So if you're, for example, running a hospital here in Florida, or you're a business associate and you process data for companies located in other states, if there's an incident, right, you have to look to the data breach notification laws for that state of residence, not where you're physically located. Okay, so FIPA requires that you take proactive, reasonable measures to secure data. There is no definition for reasonable measures. If you're subject to HIPAA, HIPAA will be used as a standard of care to measure your compliance. Okay, that's just it. That's what reasonable measures is going to mean in this case. As I mentioned, the definition here of personal information is quite broad. Social security numbers, your healthcare information, your health insurance policy number, okay? So think about that. If you're storing that, right, now what kind of protections do you have to put in place? Because certainly, you would not necessarily think that that should be treated the same way as a social security number, right? Credit card numbers, again, because of all of the thefts we've had, and a username or email address. If it's in combination with a password or security question. Okay? So again, think about what kind of protections are you using on your website, right? What are you doing to secure that information? Because now, if that's lost, that's a reportable event. Okay? The breach notification requirements are a bit different. Again, we have stricter requirements. So if you're subject to FIPA and you're a Florida business, so you are, right? HIPAA gives you 60-day notification. So for a covered entity, they have up to 60 days to notify. Certainly, it needs to be done as quickly as possible, right? Florida says, okay, if you're the covered entity, and the covered entity is defined broader than what we would see under HIPAA, but if you're a business that houses information of consumers, you have to notify the state in 30 days, okay, versus 60 under HIPAA. So that's not a very long time, right? That's a like pretty quickly that you have to do an investigation. If you are housing data for a covered entity, then you have to notify that your top line entity within 10 days, okay? So consider in that case, what do your contracts actually say? Did you account for 10-day notification in your processes? What do you do to comply with that? Because that's not a lot of time. Right? FIPA also includes data disposal provisions. So there is a data disposal law. You have to take information, you need to shred it, erase it, make it unreadable or undecipherable. That typically means you need to comply with the NIST requirements, the National Institute Standards of Technology. There's actually specific requirements for data destruction. Okay. And that's what you'll need to follow to make sure that stuff is properly erased, that it's shredded. There have been a number of settlements that deal with people who are, with companies who are improperly disposing paper records, improperly disposing of backup tapes. Okay. So it's important to keep that in mind that you need to have, in addition to, you know, what do you do with the information you house, how do you destroy it? Right? Your policies and procedures really need to live throughout the look at your entire information life cycle. Okay? There is no private right of action, which is similar to what we have under HIPAA. There's no private right of action. If you have a claim, if you lose someone's information and they take action against you, it's under state law. Okay? In Florida, you have to report the incident. If it impacts 500 or more individuals, you have to import it to the state attorney general. Okay? And they will typically ask you for a copy of the police report. So there are other obligations. You will likely need to get the police department involved. You'll need to file a report. Otherwise, there are other things that come into play. So it's important to keep that in mind. And again, if you have 10 days to notify, right, not a long time, just so you have to have processes in place to account for that. But civil penalties will not exceed $500,000. Okay, and that's, again, from the state, and it's going to go to the general revenue fund. When I see something like that, what I think of, wow, that's a really great way for the state to raise money, right? All right, so why should you care? And I'm going to briefly just talk about some of the enforcement we're seeing. The cost to remediate a data breach is very, very expensive. Okay, these are numbers from the Panamon Institute. The data is, the green line is from 2013, the red line is 2014, and the blue line is the 2015 number. So you're looking at $217 per record. How many records do you have in your organization? Multiply that by $217. Now, if you're in the healthcare space, you're looking at $363 per record. Again, how many records do you have in your organization? How much is that really going to cost you? Please buy insurance. It is a worthy investment, okay? The enforcement landscape in the healthcare space is very complicated. There are a lot of entities looking to enforce. There's a lot of organizations interested in what you're doing. And for those of you who are collecting credit card information, don't forget that you're also subject to the PCI DSS requirements, which means now we're seeing enforcement actions from credit unions and banks via class actions, okay? Credit card companies, because they want that money back, right? You've lost credit card information, that all that information, the credit card numbers have to be replaced, right? They have to give consumers back the money that was lost in fraud. Who's gonna pay for that? Well, it's you, the business owner, right? The Office of Civil Rights to date has entered into settlement agreements with about 22 organizations. The first one you see on that slide, Signet Health, was not a settlement agreement. That was actually an enforcement action, okay? And that stemmed from Signet not giving patients access to their information. And if I recall correctly, that was 43 patients. So what's 4.3 million divided by 43? Was it worth not complying with that? Probably not. Right? In that case, the actual fine was $1.3 million. The other $3 million came from Signet thinking, oh, I don't have to respond to the Office of Civil Rights. They're just going to go away if I don't answer the door. No, the regulators don't go away. They just hit you harder in the pocketbook. Okay? So it's really important that you have those processes in place. If you have a regulator knocking on your door, please let them in. Say hello. Don't say anything else. Call your attorney, okay? Some of the other organizations on here, the Alaska Department of Health and Human Services, 1.7 million. Remember that 1.5 million being the ceiling up there? No, it's not. Skagit County, Washington, 215,000. Now, if they're willing to take an enforcement action against a state entity or a small county government, what do you think they're gonna do to a business? Cornell Prescription Pharmacy, that was the latest settlement agreement, that was from April, stemmed from improper disposal of paper records. They were throwing paper records in the trash. It was reported by a news agency. The Office of Civil Rights saw that report and said, oh, this sounds like a good place for us to investigate. Right? They only owned one pharmacy, single location, paying $125,000 to settle. Okay? So again, it's really important to take a look at the entire process, right? Not just your electronic records, but also your paper records. Okay, don't forget that. I want to point out one more. Columbia University and New York and Presbyterian Hospital. The incident happened at New York and Presbyterian, but Columbia and New York had an affiliation agreement. So both of them got caught up in the investigation. Your partners, who you do business with, matters. If they're investigated, the chances that you're also going to get investigated increase. Individuals, so we're seeing a lot of class actions from consumers. I'm sure you guys have heard about, you know, the Target class actions, the Home Depot class actions. They are very, very difficult for consumers to win. Okay? Very hard, because typically the court doesn't care that your feelings were hurt because your medical information is available on Google, right? They just don't care. That's not an actionable claim. But it is very, very expensive to defend these cases. So yes, you as the company, you may win in the end. But if you just spent $50 million defending yourself, did you really win? Right? I don't think you did, because that's very expensive. On the individual side, we see these come up when there have been an improper disclosure of, typically you'll see STD-related information, something highly sensitive and personal. And so you'll see things like claims made, again, under state law, because there's no private right of action. Right? You'll see intentional infliction of emotional distress, invasion of privacy, negligent supervision. So that's a claim made against the employer. And you'll see consumers claim they'll use HIPAA as the standard of care. Okay, so for those of you thinking, okay, well, how do I actually defend against this? What's my bar, right? How do I show that I've done what I'm supposed to do? Well, you're looking at, did you comply with HIPAA? Because if that's the standard of care, that's what I'm going to use as the test. I'm going to go through and say, okay, HIPAA requires XYZ. Do you have these things, right? Did you train your workforce? If you didn't, you're not compliant, right? You're not meeting that standard of care. I have one example here for you, and this out of Indiana. This was a case that went to a jury. The jury did render a verdict. And in this case, this was one pharmacist who improperly accessed the information of one individual. The pharmacist then shared that information with her significant other. There was a love triangle, as is always the case here in these types of cases. Inevitably, there's a love triangle. And so the third party here, the guy, he sent Ms. Henchy very mean text messages, okay, based on information he saw in her medical file that he received from the pharmacist. He then proceeded to then tell Ms. Henchy's family all kinds of stuff, right? Again, not very nice, right? So Ms. Henchy sues Walgreens. She says, hey, you know, this is not okay. So as I mentioned earlier, the jury did render a verdict. How much do you think was that verdict for? If you think it was more than $250,000, raise your hands. Good, okay. What about more than $500,000? Okay. 1 million? Good. 1.8 million, with Walgreens to be responsible for 1.4 of that. So for those of you who have employees who have improperly accessed information, okay, unless you have $1.4 million sitting around in your checking account, you have to terminate that employee. One of the things that the jury found to be extremely problematic in this case was Walgreens didn't terminate the pharmacist, right? And why? Well, you're the jury, right? You put yourself in that position. How many of you have files at Walgreens, right? A lot of you are probably using Walgreens, CVS, other pharmacies. How would you feel if that was you on the other side? Right? And that's important to remember when you're looking at these cases, because you should presume that this will go to a jury. This is your indication of how the jury is going to decide. They're not forgiving. Okay. So now what you should do now, and I'm going to go ahead and turn this back over to Karl.
Okay. The things that need to really be focused on when it comes from an IT perspective is how that fits into your practice management as a whole. Because the security aspects are a holistic approach on how you train your employees, as Tatiana was mentioning, how they treat that particular patient record, and then how the IT infrastructure will affect your practice, whether or not there's connectivity issues, if machines go down because everything does eventually break, and the connectivity between cloud services, communication between other employees. Everybody thinks that they're going to capitalize on that downtime, but there's a loss in revenue to the practice because of accounts receivable, payables, patient interaction, delays there. So it's good to have an established business continuity plan that, has a list of steps and procedures that will be taken upon a detection of, downtime and so forth. And a key aspect to that is, to have a, proper data backup and disaster recovery solution. With today's technologies, you have the ability to be backing up at a, short increment of 15 minutes. So that basically turns out to identify, well, what is your pain point? How much data can you possibly lose? Well, that's also going to be able to impact your, business. So you want to be able to respond and recover as quickly as possible. There are practices because of old technologies that have been out there with tape backups and so forth. Everybody thinks that their, backup is good because the green light came on. And then they put it back into their drawer and, they go home for the night. Mm-hmm. Nobody ever does any testing to see whether or not that backup can actually be recovered. And the last time you want to, or last thing you want to do when you're in a crisis mode and in a panic-stricken situation is realize that your backups don't work. The other aspect is the, security penetration, because you know, everybody thinks that things are working just fine and not having any problems, but they don't realize that people are trying to actually attack that network through malicious attempts to breach the security of that network infrastructure. So to try and do penetration testings to actually, from a white hat perspective, see what the security issues are on that environment, to see what ports are open, what restrictions are enabled on that network so that you can maintain that ongoing security aspect. And as Tatiana mentioned, the, big aspect is with the process management or policy management. When you're actually deleting files and, disposing of records and maintaining that, all the information needs to be encrypted, both in rest and in transmission of that data. So all your hard drives in your environment, they should be encrypted. When you transmit data from a cloud provider or communicate with patient records, that all, that data should be encrypted. And that also then comes into play when you actually want to dispose of an old computer or an old copy machine. The problem is, that when you actually delete a file and you can see a lot of this stuff on NCIS and that kind of thing, when you look at a hard drive, you can actually still pull data off of that. There's been cases where people have disposed of a hard drive, they haven't properly wiped that information correctly, and that information then can get retrieved. People have used copiers within their infrastructure. They've leased the equipment, returned it, and didn't realize that all those copies that they were making on patient records were actually resident within the machine itself. So you need to establish certain access controls, and if you approach everything from a need-to-know basis and establish permissions within that IT infrastructure, then the only people that need to access that information will be the only people able to access that information. And then you need to also go through constant remediation aspects. There are HIPAA IT risk assessments that need to be done on a recurring basis, and there's no definition of what recurring is, so it kind of defaults down to at least once a year. But just because you have an IT risk assessment, you have to then move forward in remediating against those findings, and if you don't, it's as if you hadn't done one at all. So to try and take a approach with, to try and take additional ongoing remediation steps, you need to try and identify where your pain points are and to develop a, policy procedure around that. I think this one slide might be out of order. The best way to do it is to try and take a proactive approach to things rather than a reactive one. So if you can monitor through security checks of intrusion prevention, ensuring that your data backups are working and that they're being tested, that there's redundancy in the environment in case there's downtime, these are all best practices to move forward with. And by working with technology approach that is in concert with your practice management, then you'll know that you're meeting your requirements for that. The best thing when it comes to the policy approach is to identify vulnerabilities before they happen so you can secure your environment rather than responding to a breach to it. The best way is to try and take a managed approach to compliance. You need to do regular IT risk assessments and deal with a compliance monitoring perspective. What kind of reports for the all the audit reports that are required for identifying key areas of your infrastructure that may be vulnerable. And you can take a holistic approach to identifying those key holes and remediating against it. One other key area is the security of the network itself. As I mentioned, people are going to try and attack the network by seeing what kind of ports are open in the firewalls, what kind of security settings you have on your websites, whether or not it's a SSL certificate for security encryption. You need to monitor the environment so that it's segmented out to access only those people that have permission to access that data. The continuity plan is a big area to focus on too, because when you have downtime in your environment, that's going to affect your interaction with your patients, the reputation with your patients. It's going to also affect your revenue stream because you can't deal with accounts receivable, your payables, and so forth. And there are different technologies that are coming out, and Jeff alluded to this in the beginning. There's a what I term as a paradigm conversions that's occurring between IT and the medical. As medical is going more digital and taking advantage of a lot of these cloud-based solutions, there's a plethora of approaches when it comes to that too. There's public clouds, there's private clouds, there's connectivity to those cloud providers. And if you don't maintain and monitor those and make sure that those business association agreements are in place to protect that, you open yourself up to some vulnerabilities. And the last time to identify a crisis is not when you're in the midst of a crisis. So you want to be able to test your backups to make sure that they're working correctly. There's technological changes when it comes from, in the old days, moving from tape, which degrade over time and unreliable, to solutions that are both on-premise and cloud-based so that in the event of catastrophe, a storm comes through, there's a flood in the building, the construction that's going on down the street takes out your internet connectivity, to make sure that there's some redundancy in your environment so that the practice ultimately can continue despite the impact of your of what's going on in your environment. The other thing is to deal with a more unified approach to communication, so that can tie into how you communicate with your email services, your fax services. Everything needs to be transmitted encrypted. So when it comes into email communications, there's essentially like a herd mentality that occurs and say, well, okay, I'm going to use Gmail. Well, Gmail in and of itself, unless taking the proper precautions, isn't HIPAA compliant. It can be, but a lot of times everybody just signs up for a Gmail account and goes forward until they realize that those settings and whatnot are not in place so that that encryption is not occurring. Same holds true with the emails that are sent. There's ways of detecting rules within the email so that it can indicate to you that it has to be sent out encrypted and that secured email services are available for that. there's collaboration services within the organization that you can occur. And this is commonly known as the Dropbox problem. Everybody wants to share files amongst their organization, and they use a Dropbox type of approach. The problem with that is that everybody has personal Dropbox systems as well, so there's a data sprawl that occurs as you're trying to sync up your account with the collaboration of file exchange. That information can sprawl across the personal accounts of the Dropbox user as well, so there then comes a problem of a data breach to occur. So you need to realize that there's control that needs to be put in place from the organizational perspective rather than trying to count on the administrative capabilities of the services that you use, because ultimately the responsibility is going to rest with you. The other aspect that comes into play is the what's referred to as the BYOD, the bring your own device. Everybody has smartphones, they want to be able to interact with the data that they have, and a lot of practices or businesses, rather than going through the cost of extending out a smartphone to the employee, will allow them to use their own device and access the information internally. There needs to be policy procedures that are overlaid on those devices so that you can manage the security aspect, the authentication aspects, the encryption aspects of that phone, and even deny some services while they're in that practice. You know, turning off the phone aspects or what have the camera aspects. That comes into the collaboration aspects of those file sharing capabilities. That can be a good convenience to make things work more efficiently, but you have to make sure that those collaboration utilities are HIPAA compliant, that the synchronization occurs internally and has the access controls defined for them. So the mobility, the security of the mobility needs to be ensured, and that will then prevent the data sprawl aspects that occur or can commonly occur. Now we'll move on to the legal aspects of where we should be going right now.
Thank you. So when the regulators come in and they do an analysis, or they're looking at, there's been an action and now they're doing an investigation, or maybe you're subject to one of the OCR HIPAA compliance audits, what they want to know is, have you done a risk analysis? Really, that's your first stop in any good compliance program, is have you done a risk analysis? And has it been a thorough and complete analysis? It is very important that when you're looking at these issues, that you really track the flow of the PHI throughout your network. The first step in that is to understand where your information is housed, right? Where is your information actually stored? Are you sure those computers that you have standing in the corner that no one's used in 5 years don't have any PHI? Right? It's really important to consider all of those aspects. One of the issues that is frequently overlooked in a risk analysis is cloud computing services, right? Your Office 365 email, whatever you're using for data storage, right? You don't have to go into too much detail, but it needs to be at least recognized in your risk analysis that there are certain risks posed by using cloud-based services, right? And how are you remediating against those risks? What policies and procedures do you have in place? Are there specific technical requirements that you've taken to mitigate those risks? But you have to identify them first, right? In any good risk analysis, you're going to have, at the very least, a vulnerability scan. If your risk analysis proposal from your third-party vendor does not include that, you need to specifically include that in the request. That may be an additional cost. If you've had a vulnerability scan done, or you do those on a regular basis, then you need to have a penetration test done. Okay? No risk analysis is complete without that. Okay? The risk analysis should also include an on-site walkthrough. I typically do recommend that you have some third party who's not familiar with your system do the on-site walkthrough. Why? Well, it's because when I walk through your office and I see all of those passwords are all over the place, or I see those checks sitting out there because you're doing payroll today, that's going to send up red flags for me. But it may not send up red flags from you because that's your practice, right? That's what you guys always do, and you won't recognize that that's an issue, okay? Make sure you're reviewing your online monitoring programs, okay? The risk analysis should consider, what are you doing with your employees? How do you track what they're doing? Are you actually looking at those audit reports, right? When was the last time you reviewed the audit reports? Do you get audit reports, right? Does your system actually track when people access information, or does it only track when people modify information? That's a really important distinction, because consider, if your system doesn't track access, your employee can go in, take all of those Social Security numbers from all of your clients, and you would never know it, because you have no way of knowing whether or not they access that information. It's a pretty significant risk, so you don't find out until, hey, you get a knock on your door from the FBI, okay, or the state police department, because they found all of these records in someone's trunk when they got pulled over. Now, that actually happens all the time. It's unfortunate, but it does. Make sure, again, you look at the entire flow of EPHI, your printers, fax machines, anything that has a hard drive can store information. This slide comes from the SANS Institute, which is an IT security organization, and the data was compiled by the Norris Institute, which is a cybersecurity firm. They reviewed terabytes and terabytes of data. Now, these items that are on this list, this is where they found malicious traffic. These were the originating points of malicious traffic. Now, look at the bottom there. You've got your firewall and your VPN. Those are the things that you use to protect your information, right? That's not good if they're the source of the malicious traffic. Again, are you really looking at all of the devices when you're evaluating your system, right? Don't assume, well, this is what I use for protection. This is going to be okay. No, that's not true. Check your documentation. Who's in charge of compliance? Okay. Are you documenting everything in the healthcare space? If you don't document it, you didn't do it. That is just the rule, right? I have no way to prove that all those great things in your head actually happened, right? Because you didn't document anything. This is a summary of one of the slides from the HIPAA audits that were done by the Office of Civil Rights a couple of years ago. For every issue that was identified, the auditors looked for a cause, right? Why was there an issue with the compliance? Okay. The most common answer was that the entity was unaware of the requirement. This means that someone didn't read the statute, right? Again, who's in charge of your compliance? Did they read the rules, right? Because it's written down. You just have to open up the regulation, okay? The other item that was listed is complete disregard. Just don't care, right? Okay. And lack of application of sufficient resources. Right? Compliance isn't free. You need to have a budget line item for compliance. If you want to operate in a regulated space, this is the cost of doing business. Please. I'm assuming that most of you in here are probably business associates or subcontractors, right? Make sure that you're looking at your master agreements and compare that to what you're seeing in your business associate requirements. Your business associate contract, despite what you may hear from the covered entities, it is a document that is frequently negotiated. I know this because I do this for a living, right? I negotiate these contracts all the time. That document needs to be tailored to the services that you provide. So for example, if you don't communicate with patients as part of the services you provide, there is absolutely no reason for you to assume that responsibility in your business associate contract. Why? Because that creates additional risks for you as the business associate, right? You need to go through and take out the things that don't actually apply to you because you don't do that service, okay? Additionally, make sure that you're looking at the indemnification and the limitation of liability. Particularly if the service you provide is reliant in part on your business partner being compliant, right? Because if I am providing you managed IT services, but you can go in and change all kinds of stuff to screw up all my settings, should I be the one responsible for that, right? No, absolutely not. So you need to make sure you're looking at that documentation to make sure that your contracts actually appropriately apportion liability and responsibility, right? So your business associate contract should say, hey, covered entity, here's the kind of stuff you also have to comply with, right? It's not just me doing all the work. Security takes all of us, right? I can't do the security by myself, right? Also, please, please, please buy insurance, okay? Make sure that you look at that policy very, very carefully. Many of the policies will exclude, for example, coverage for losses for data that's stored in the cloud. Now, if you happen to be using Office 365 for your email, what value is that insurance policy to you, right? Another frequent requirement in these policies is whether or not your devices have been encrypted. Now, are you sure you can encrypt every single device? What if you're just switching out a laptop? What if you're switching out, you know, you give someone temporary use of a laptop because they maybe lost theirs, or you're doing upgrades? What value is that policy to you that's supposed to protect you in case of a data breach if you have to encrypt everything all the time, if that's the sole purpose of you getting that policy? Okay? And unfortunately for you, insurance companies, they don't necessarily want to pay out, right? They're going to look for these things and they will use that against you. There's a case out of California that was filed in May against a health system where the insurance company sold a cyber liability policy and is now seeking to recoup $4.3 million that they paid out to settle a class action. Because they're arguing, hey, you know, you told us that you take certain policies and procedures with respect to your business associates, that you have requirements for them. Well, the breach happened at your business associate. Guess what? Your business associate was judgment proof, so we covered everything. But because you didn't comply with all of this stuff that you told us you do, we want our money back. So it's really important that you understand what you're buying, because why pay for something if you can't actually use it? Okay. Finally, when you have an indemnification provision that says that I'm going to indemnify you for anything and everything that happens, it's fantastic. I love to see those. But what value is that if you're judgment proof? You don't have any money to pay. So who cares if you've given me unlimited indemnification, right? I want proof that you have insurance. I want to see a copy of that certificate. Okay, now on to Jeff.
All right, so just a couple of points before I kind of talk out, you know, why is a healthcare banker involved in this? But, you know, we haven't covered a lot of things that are coming up in the IT as far as data security space, as far as telemedicine, telehealth. I mean, think about the number of items that we're going to have to be concerned about in coverage in the healthcare space of data security. Under telehealth, there'd be more of information, and then telemedicine, of course, would be the video. Okay, so that's more to come as we move into that space, and that's happening. As far as what I cover would be more to say, banks in general, if you think about it, over time have been the target primarily for data, you know, data breaches, data security, and protecting your money, right? Protecting your information. So that's a big part of what we do for ourselves to protect you, but then also the services to offer you to protect your business, your practice, as well as your patients' information, okay? So some of the things that we recommend as far as what are available to, you know, from your bank to protect that you need to be aware of is number one is ACH, electronic positive pay. So basically there's services out there where you can tell the bank what should be coming in, what should be taken out, so that the numbers and everything match up from who should be paying you electronically. Okay, so that's something, so all of a sudden it doesn't just pop up and then you're unaware of it, and then you only have so much time in order to make sure to rebuttal that, to say that this is not something that I did and that should not be debited from my account. Online bill pay, paying vendors electronically except for, you know, not, instead of checks. Checks are one of the biggest ways as far as to say somebody can get your information of your checking account. They have your signature, your business name, your bank name, your account number, your check number, you know, They have all that information, and easy enough in these days, they could make an electronic debit from your checking just with that information or print off other checks. Okay, so online bill pay, secure way to pay vendors to pay payments. Something to consider. I'm sorry. Universal Payment Identification Code, UPIC. A lot of banks do not tell their clients about this. We do, because it's an important thing. It's more of a national type of account. So no matter where you bank, you can tie your primary account to this UPIC account number. Give that account number to your payers who are supposed to be electronically crediting your account. They only electronically can credit your account. They cannot debit the account. So that's a nice feature there against fraud, external fraud, is that it only accepts electronic credits. Okay? And so why banks don't like it is it makes it easier for someone to change banks, right? So you just link a new account to this universal account number, and it makes it very simple. Okay? So something really to talk to your bank about and put in place. The other part of it is obviously not just protecting your practice, your business, but what about your clients or your patients? Okay, so that's just as important. So the couple of things are more of the focus in, say, more of the merchant services side is tokenization with credit card processing. You know, that's a service that's out there. Not by all, unfortunately, but there are processors that offer that so that it's just, you know, again, making it more difficult as possible for anybody to steal that credit card information. Okay, EMV chip, credit card, and MS merchant service terminals, MS terminals. So in October of this year, that's something that's changing where businesses' practices will have to be compliant in getting new technology to read and process the chip credit cards, which make it, upon swipe, you know, extremely difficult for anybody to steal. If you do not have new technology in place and something happens, guess what? You're liable. Period. So, and then also to say, if credit card information is stolen and you're found to be at fault, guess what? There's penalties in place. There's the ability of never to be able to process MasterCard Visa again, and as well as to say, you know, the impact to your clients and patients. Okay, so some services really to think about as far as to protect your business, your practice's financial information, to protect your patients, your clients' information, and overall, you know, in the end, we want to protect, you know, what we have our investment in is our business, right? Our livelihood. So with that, that's a disclosure that I always have to give on the presentation to say, I am not a professional in these areas, but I have the experience in order to, you know, communicate the proper information. With that, we went a little over, but you can hopefully see that there's some great information that we covered, which is a lot, and that, you know, if there's some questions that everyone would like to ask, please do so.
Was it everything I promised? These are true experts, and this is exactly the kind of information that you get here at MOROF. Now, we do have time for a couple of questions here, and I want to tell you two things. Firstly, that we're going to have a brief message at the end of this from our sponsor, and that is going to be important. That's Karl Muhlbach talking about his company, but he's also going to incorporate in that a special offer. Before we do that, we are going to take a couple of questions. I also want to let you know that this conversation, which is a very deep and very broad one, will be continued online. We have through LinkedIn an open group of MOROF, and if you have any questions that we don't get to, pose them there because they will be addressed there. And of course, finally, if the whole high tech side of things fails, don't worry. You can always have your office cleaners come in and access your filing cabinets. All right, we have a question over here, if you'll wait for me to get to you with the microphone.
Thank you. First of all, great presentation. I want to add something to what Tatiana was saying and have a question for Karl. Tatiana, I just want to add that those people who are participants in an ACO, because the CMS has the data agreement with the organizations, your breach notification timing is 1 day. Mm-hmm. So therefore, let's be careful. In fact, 1 hour. So you almost mm-hmm. have to be very, very careful with that card. Lot of my clients ask me, I'm an attorney like Tatiana, that they have bought these new computers which say that they are HIPAA compliant. Could you address and tell us what does that mean? And secondly, for those who are buying security, because there are many of us who are business associates at the very least or subcontractors, as Tatiana said, what level of security should we be getting at the very least?
What level of what?
Security.
Okay.
Well,
it's the level of protection that incurs. To address your first question first, when something's labeled HIPAA compliant, what does that mean? More often than not, that just implies that it has the capability of being HIPAA compliant. The services have to have certain configuration settings. The hard drives in that case would have to be using the encryption aspects that come with the operating system. The virus protections, the Nortons and so forth, that's good for detection of something that is brought in from an email or a virus that could come in from a USB drive that might be inserted. And you want to deal with a company or a program that has the capabilities of responding and detecting those alerts. So it's a matter of how often are those security updates being done? How often are the lists that it compares to the known viruses that are out there to check against, how often are they being updated? So just because you have Norton or Bitdefender or whatever the antivirus software is, if you're not maintaining a process and a procedure in place to maintaining up-to-date records with that so it has something to check against, that's where some of the vulnerabilities come into play. Excuse me.
I'd just like to add just a brief comment to that. When someone tells you that they're HIPAA compliant, you should say, okay, that's fantastic. How did you achieve that status? Because there is no certifying body that talks about who's HIPAA compliant, right? What steps did they take? Who did their risk analysis? Was it done internally? And if so, what's the training level of that person that did that analysis? Right? Can they give you a third-party attestation statement from the vendor that did that analysis? When was it last done? Right? How often did they do a HIPAA risk analysis? Because you may be HIPAA compliant today, but tomorrow you're not. Right? So it's really important to keep that in mind. HIPAA is a very flexible standard. And we need that because it applies to significant number of entities, right? The requirements that I may have as an attorney are different than what you would see at, you know, a 5-campus hospital, right? And so HIPAA has to accommodate all of that. So it's really important to really start poking at that and ask your vendors what they're doing, okay?
And that's why it's important to maintain a compliance process. Just because you do a HIPAA risk assessment, as Tatiana said, next week you may not be compliant because of the things that are changing within the environment. So to have an ongoing managed compliance approach to maintain those and identify those risks, that's the best practice.
Real quick question was, I have a practice. We use everything cloud-based, our practice management, EHR, our telemedicine portal, everything. Does that come with lower risk then? Because we don't have even a server that somebody could even get into at that point.
No. Right? So you're the covered entity. Yes. Ultimately, under the law, you're primarily responsible. So I would say, okay, that's great. You have given some of these risks to your vendors, okay? What do your contracts say? That would be my first stop, because typically what you'll see is your contracts will say something like, we are responsible for, we agree to indemnify you, and our liability is capped to the amount you paid us in the 12 months preceding the claim, okay? So what happens if that data breach happens a year after your contract is canceled? Right, you've terminated the contract, they've retained your data for whatever reason, right? Probably because you've given them certain rights in that agreement. What happens for that after a year after? Well, you haven't paid them anything. So who bears the burden in that case? You do, completely. So it's really important to take a look at that documentation, and again, please buy your own insurance. Make sure that your insurance covers cloud-based services, and that's one way to mitigate those risks.
I'm sure we have a MOROF member who will help you with your insurance requirements.
I just wanted to mention that when Tatiana and I, we spoke earlier about how to know what areas of your data to protect, and I'd like for you to reiterate that to the group because I think that's very important because, you, as you mentioned, you can't segment that.
Susie asked earlier about how do you actually carry out a compliance program? What do you do to protect the data, and how do you decide what data to protect? Because as we saw when we compare HIPAA versus FIPA, right, you have a broader scope of data that's covered under FIPA versus what you have under HIPAA. So typically what you would generally see, the easiest approach for most companies is to pick one level of compliance and implement it throughout your entire organization to all of the data. Don't say, okay, well, this is this type of data, I'm only going to secure it up to this level. Or this is this type of data, and I'm only going to secure it up to this other level. Because when you start segmenting the data, you need to have additional processes and protocols in place to make those decisions. Or do you then just leave it up to your front staff office person to decide how that's going to be protected? Right? So if you have one process in place, one, it's easier for you to comply. It's easier to train on that process versus training on multiple processes. And then when you have a data breach, right, how do you know what to do? Because you've already implemented different segmentation. How do you figure out, okay, how do I notify and whether or not I need to notify based on that? Right? It just makes notification and making those determinations more complicated on the back end. And I do say when you have a data breach, because chances are you've probably already had one.
Actually, I have a question, if I may. There are increasingly not-for-profit organizations which serve minority areas of the community as far as the healthcare side of things is concerned. Clearly, they don't have much in the way of budget, but obviously they need some protections. Can you comment on whether or not there is any kind of an exemption for that, or are they just as liable as everybody else?
So if they're covered entities, they're going to be liable just like everyone else. And I think we saw that in the settlement agreements from the Office of Civil Rights. I mean, they cover everyone. If they're going to cover a state agency, which you would say, hey, maybe they have some state immunities, right? They're going to apply to nonprofits. Fortunately, though, there are, I think, a lot of free options organizations can use to comply. For example, if you have the new operating system from Windows, you have Windows 8, right? BitLocker is included. It's a compliant encryption program. Certified, right, or it's FIPS 140-2 validated, which is really what you want, and it's free. You just have to turn it on, right? But you have to know that it's there, and you have to turn it on. I'll defer to Karl to talk maybe about some of the other free options available.
There are organizations that will work with nonprofits to deal with that disparity in revenue and resources. The BitLocker that Tatiana mentioned is one aspect of trying to use some of the capabilities that come with these operating systems and services that are provided. But a lot of it is to make sure that you're actually making use of those types of things. And that's what people need to overcome, is to understand that they have some disposal of resources available to them, but they're not taking advantage of those. So most of the BitLocker being FIPS compliant, there's different types of AES, 256, now I'm going to get a little technical, but it's a military grade encryption process that needs to be maintained through the process.
Well, thank you all very much indeed for coming this morning. I'd like us to acknowledge our speakers and to thank them very much for their time and expertise.